My name is Torsten Bell. I'm the director of the Resolution Foundation. For those of you that don't know, we're a think tank that focuses on the living standards of people on low and middle incomes. Now, this is a rammed room, and you're about to sit through a typically graph-heavy Resolution Foundation slide pack. So you might be thinking you're not very lucky people, but I just want to be clear that you are the lucky few, because this event is three times oversubscribed today, so we're glad you're here. Now, what does that tell us? It tells us about the stage of the debate that we've got to on tax credits. So the way I would think about it is, over the summer, we were in a phase which was called crisis, what crisis? Where people weren't quite sure how many people were losing, who the losers were from tax credits. And we got over that fairly swiftly at Conservative Party conference, with the likes of Tim and others making clear cases. And then we moved to a phase which was generally called in politics, something must be done. That's normally the informal part of the policy discussion, where people have wild ideas about things that could be done and no idea about what will actually work. Now, hopefully today we're going to draw a close to that phase of the debate and move to the what could be done. And so what we're going to present to you today is a comprehensive audit of what the Chancellor and the Treasury could do in the autumn statement. Now, this is complex stuff, I should start by adding, but the good news is that we have Gary Gibbon as a chair for this event, who is used to complex stuff as the political editor of Channel 4 News for some considerable time. So I want to say thank you to Gary for chairing us today, thank you all for coming, and thank you to our panel. I hope we have a great discussion.
Thank you very much indeed. I'll introduce the panel to you, and then we'll kick off straight away with the presentation. It's mad, really, but none of them need an introduction. We have Julia Unwin from the Joseph Rowntree Foundation, who's probably done more than any other individual to get in people's heads the idea of what poverty looks like at the moment and how so much of it is working poverty. We have Frank Field, who is known to absolutely everyone and who is currently nibbling George Osborne's ankles the way he was Gordon Brown's. And we have Tim Montgomery, who's going to talk as well to us about the politics of tax credits, in which he may even make some critical remarks about George Osborne before tomorrow leaving the country for America. I'm sure those two things aren't connected at all. But first of all, presentation, and I'd like to ask David Finch, the Resolution Foundation, to show you his numbers.
Thank you.
Cheers.
Before I start, I'm just going to re-emphasise something that Torsten just said, which is that this is quite a chart-heavy presentation. There's plenty of technical detail in here, so I'm going to try and skim through the highlights quite quickly. We're publishing this on our website, so please do digest the detail at your leisure, and then if you have any questions about the detail, get back to me. But I'm going to start first by considering the impact of the summer budget in 2016, and then I'll move on to potential ways that the losses can be mitigated. So first looking at the effects of the changes on incomes, and I think I'm sure most of you will be familiar with these measures, but I'm just going to outline them quickly. So there's some key boosts to income coming from raising the wage floor through the National Living Wage and some further tax cuts. But at the same time, there are some quite significant cuts to income through cuts to tax credits. And the main two of these, especially in 2016, are the reduction in the income threshold. Now, this is the point at which your earnings start to get held against your tax credit entitlement. And then also increasing the taper, which is effectively the rate at which your benefits are withdrawn as your earnings rise. More widely, there's a freeze to working age benefits, but with inflation so low, and in fact being slightly negative in the period it counts for benefit uprating, it's not really going to have an effect next year. And there's also the benefit cap is reduced, but again, that tends to affect this one of the people, so we're not really focusing on those today. So the good news is that the gains from the National Living Wage and the tax cuts do provide, it's a relatively small but it's a fairly even boost to income across the distribution. So this chart is just showing how the percentage gain to income across the income distribution, moving from the poorest households on the left-hand side to the richest households on the right-hand side. And that's a fairly evenly spread share of gains. But what about the losses? So the cuts to the tax credits, this is just the income threshold, and it's the biggest and most regressive impact of the tax credit cuts. And it's providing a significant reduction in income to those in the bottom half of the income distribution. And the cuts to the taper just builds on those cuts even further. And when you take them all together, we can clearly see that there's a significant cut to income for households in the bottom half of the income distribution, but then some modest gains across the top half of the income distribution. When we talk about the overall impact on households with tax credits, there's about 3.3 million working households who are having an average drop in income of £1,300 on the tax credits, but that's slightly offset by some of these gains that we've seen. So on average, the net loss is around £1,100 a year. And as some of our previous analysis have shown, we expect these changes to push around 100,000 working households into poverty next year. But the changes aren't only about income, they're also about the incentive structures that the tax credit system provides. I'm going to apologise in advance for these charts, because this is sort of where we start to get into the more technical aspects of things. Essentially, this chart is showing how net income changes as somebody works more hours. We've gone all the way up to 70 hours just to show how things happen at high levels of earnings, but we wouldn't realistically expect them to work that much. And the key things to pull out here are that in the current tax credit system, as someone starts work, there's very little incentive to work short hours because out-of-work benefits are clawed back pound for pound. But the tax credit system provides a significant boost to start working. In the case of a couple, it's at 24 hours, and then there's a further boost at 30 hours. But beyond these points, once you start to take into account the fact that the speed at which tax credits are withdrawn and also the payment of tax and national insurance, people are only keeping around 27 pence for an additional pound earned. So there's a strong incentive to get into work and work up to around full-time hours, but to really push on in your earnings, the incentives are quite weak. Now, the impact of the summer budget is to pull that line down through the reduction in the income threshold, as it's a kind of straight shot to income, reducing incomes by around £1,000 a year. And then the increase in the taper makes that incentive to progress even poorer. So we can see that people will only keep around 20 pence an hour, only about 20p of every extra pound earned, because the what we call marginal deduction rate has increased to 80%. So I've gone through that quite quickly, so it's just trying to get us into the sort of same place on the different effects. But now I'm going to think around more around how these losses can be potentially offset. So we've already seen that the boost to the national living wage and the tax cuts have offset the losses in 2016 slightly. So what if the full increase to the national living wage was brought forward to 2016? And what if the pledge to reach the personal allowance of £12,500 was brought forward to 2016? Now, we're not advocating that that should happen, because it'd be very expensive, and in the case of the national living wage, probably cause some big difficulties with businesses. But the important thing to note is that those things simply don't offset the losses to any significant degree. And that's because, and the reason we think this is because we think they have a limited overlap. So those gains don't help the tax credit population very much, they're helping the broader population. They tend to be progressive. And in the case of the personal allowance, they'd be very expensive. So it costs around £9 billion just to offset that extra £200 of income. Something else that's been talked around is the effect that extra childcare support can have on offsetting these losses. Now, obviously extra support with childcare is very welcome, but those extra 15 hours for working families will only help someone with a 3 or 4 year old, and they're only coming in September 2017. If we look at the tax credit population in isolation, only around 10% of those in work have got a child under 5 and are currently claiming for help with their childcare costs. So that suggests that the offsetting the gains from this extra the extra 15 hours are only going to help a very small part of the tax credit population. And they're already receiving 70% of their support of 70% of their costs. You could potentially think around bringing some additional support into tax credits. So in the universal credit, the level of support is set to rise to 85%, and that was meant to be going in April, but with the delays in bringing universal credit in, you could think about bringing that into the tax credit system. Again, it's only going to help the 400,000 families that currently pay to use childcare, so it's simply not going to help to offset these losses. So we think this additional support is welcome, but it's limited relevance. So in conclusion, making changes outside of the welfare system simply doesn't work, and that's because there's a lack of overlap between the tax credit population and those who benefit from the measures we've been talking about. So if we compensate from elsewhere, one possible alternative to take is to try and delay the impact. So if we phase in the cuts, so that's sort of slowly build the extent of the cuts over time, it would give people opportunity to have their incomes rise due to real wage gains, further income tax cuts, and the rising wage floor. And it would overnight reduce the extent of losses. So you may see only a fifth of the losses in the first year. But it's also going to have an impact on government savings because we're not taking as much away in tax credits. But I think the important thing to note is that however these changes are phased in, we still expect in 2020 the bulk of families around £2.7 million will be worse off from the cut. Now that estimate is done on the sort of standard measure of approach we would usually take, where we compare incomes in 2020 to before and after the budget, which is basically assessing the impact of those changes. But people are also talking about whether people would be better off than today in the future as a different measure. So saying, does a loss to your income next year, at what point do those other factors help to bring your income back up to what it was today? And how fast is that happening? So we're taking the distribution of losses caused in 2016, and in this chart what we can see is there's a very small amount of people gaining a very small amount. There's a bit of a spike where people are losing a small amount as well, and then the rest of the losses are spread out going up to £3,000. The thing to note about this is that I'm going to move through the years going forward to see how this might change in time, but just to note that I'm keeping this constant in the tax credit population, so I'm not thinking about universal credit. And we also, our modelling also does something called picks up only full entitlement, so it doesn't account for people that may not bother to claim any small amounts of benefits. To that extent, we think that the kind of estimates of people with very small losses or very small gains are probably overestimates of the actual impact. If we flip to 2017, so this is just allowing for a year of wage growth, some additional tax cuts, and a further rise in the national living wage. Actually, incomes in 2017 compared to what they would have been in 2016 before the cuts, a very little change. There's a very small increase in gainers, but generally lots of people are worse off. And that's the picture we have right the way through until 2020, where you still got bulk of people, so around 2.6 million families losing, and those losses have increased slightly, and that's partly because some people are gaining and they've moved out of the population that lives. But the important message to take out of this is that even if you delay the full implementation of tax credit cuts and phase them in slowly over this parliament, you're still going to see, by the time you get to the full implementation of the cuts, many families worse in 2020 than they would be today. We're also accounting for the additional rise in the personal allowance means there's going to be very little offsetting impact. And that's as we've already covered, there's very little overlap between people gaining from the personal allowance rises and the people losing from the tax credit cuts. So in summary, phasing in the cuts would reduce the size of losses in the early years, but compensation certainly does not build up from wider factors. So if we can't phase them in, another approach would be to introduce some transitional protection. So this is effectively only allowing the cuts to apply to new clients. Our best estimate of how many families this would affect is around 300,000 a year. So effectively this would limit the scale of losses only to that small cohort of families in each year, which will also have a feeder effect on the scale of savings that would be possible over the parliament. So we're effectively significantly reducing the numbers affected, but also significantly reducing the savings that are possible. But this isn't purely about the kind of savings and numbers affected. We're ignoring the longer-term picture. So the place we're moving to is a universal credit where some of the work incentives are being significantly undermined by the cuts in the summer budget. And it also creates a perverse incentive for families who think they may lose out from their more generous current tax credit entitlement to try and stay on the regime and not look to progress in work. So we think this reduces the number of losers in the near term, but it's going to reduce savings and create some perverse incentives. So far we've seen that as any measures that effectively help to mitigate the damage to incomes are also going to be reducing the level of savings that can be made. And that is just simply part of what's called the iron triangle of welfare reform, where there are three constant trade-offs in any change to the welfare system, where you're trading off the amount of income people get, the incentives they have to work, and also the cost of the taxpayer. The summer budget changes have very firmly helped to reduce the cost of the taxpayer, but they're hitting work incentives and also household incomes. So we're just going to look at different ways you could effectively tinker with the tax credit system to try and offset some of the worst impacts of the changes, but bearing these three trade-offs in mind. So we're turning now to the work incentive, the sort of net income charts we saw earlier. The key point here is the blue line is showing where we were before the budget, and the gold line is where we are after the budget. And the red line is what these different policy changes, where that takes us back to. So if we say restore the income threshold changes, then we see the losses for those with lowest incomes restored, but you're still having a very low incentive to progress and earn more. And the losses for higher income families aren't completely offset. And this is also obviously coming at a cost. So this would reverse the most regressive element of the cuts, but it's coming at quite a cost. Alternatively, we could look at the taper rate instead. But this is going to do very, so if we reverse the cut, the rise in the taper rate, it's going to do very little to mitigate the losses of income at the bottom end. It's going to restore that kind of already quite weak incentive to progress. So it helps to restore incentives, but the most progressive cuts will remain. Further way of dealing with this would be to try and offset those costs we're creating by making these changes, by making other parts through offsetting it to other parts of the tax credit system. So if we restored that income threshold, for example, we could then look to claw back the cost of that through a higher taper rate. But in doing so in this version here, we basically restored the income threshold, which means that the lowest income people aren't affected by the cuts. But that's creating a cost, and to try and reduce that cost, we're going to effectively increase the taper rate and claw that cost back from the higher earners within tax credits. But doing so creates this kind of basically effectively 100%, almost 100% taper rate, so there'd be absolutely no incentive to progress anymore. And it also may not fully cover the cost of those changes. So doing so, trying to offset the cost from within the tax credit system could help to tackle the most regressive element, but you're really going to undermine some of those incentives to progress. And now, just to really confuse you, I'm going to move to what this looks like in universal credit in 2020 as well. I apologise for doing so, but it's quite important. If we effectively, universal credit has a work allowance and a taper, and the work allowance means that you can earn up to a certain amount before your benefits start to be withdrawn. So it really improves the incentive to start working. But beyond the point the work allowance runs out, the incentive to progress is quite weak. So we think there's a kind of sweet spot at the point that the work allowance runs out. And in the chart shown above, it's the point at which someone's earning £329 in the pre-budget version of universal credit was that kind of sweet spot. Now the summer budget shifted that sweet spot down to around £240 a week, which is effectively working around 10 hours. So the changes in the summer budget are effectively increasing the risk that people become trapped at quite low hours of work at no levels of earnings. So you could think to try and offset this by increasing the taper. So if you tried to increase the taper rate, so you're clawing income back from people with high levels of earnings to boost that incentive to start working, you can increase that sweet spot back up to around 14 hours perhaps, but then your incentives to progress are much worse. And you're the cuts have already seen a significant undermining of the incentives of universal credit, and any further tinkering is just going to make that much worse. So just to sum that up, then, we think in trying to reverse these cuts, restoring the income threshold would seem to be the priority that's the most regressive of all the cuts and has having the biggest impact on incomes both in 2016 and further forward into the world of universal credit. But trying to offset that cost, trying to do that by pushing the taper higher in tax credits, is really going to ruin some of those incentives to progress. There's a little bit more scope in universal credit to increase the taper, but it's still, with the level of cuts that have already happened to it, fundamentally damaging the work incentives. So far, I've basically presented bad news and walked out pretty much most of the mitigation strategies that are possible. But we don't think it's all bad news, and that's because we think you can still reverse these cuts and stay within the government's existing fiscal plans. So by 2020, the savings from the tax credit cuts to the threshold and the taper are equal around 3.6 billion. And we've set out a range of different possible options from which you could fund reversing those cuts. Now, these are just a sample of possibilities, but the thing to pull out from them is that they will affect a much broader base of people. So you could take some money out of tax reliefs where spend has increased significantly over recent years. Basic state pension has been increased by beyond earnings. And also further income tax cuts are basically providing gains to the majority of the working population, but not helping out the low-income working population. It's also worth noting that with the surplus to be grown in 2020, there's already enough in there for the Chancellor to potentially offset these savings and stay within his fiscal framework. But we just want to focus in on the cuts to income tax. That's partly because it's something that has previously been aimed at low-earning people, and yet we're seeing low earnings particularly hit by the tax credit cuts. But if we look at the impact of those tax cuts, they're highly regressive. So around 4/5 of the gains are going to the top half of the income distribution. So cancelling those cuts would reverse that regressive policy, and channeling that money towards tax credit to reverse the tax credit cuts would be a much more progressive move. Just to wind up from what I've gone through so far, so there aren't any simple or free solutions to the tax credit problem. Wider offsetting forces are not going to be significant enough to help to offset these losses. And a choice of either phasing in the changes or transitioning them in more slowly is still going to leave a lot of people worse off and some reverse incentives created in the system. But we do think that there is room to find funding to reverse these cuts in a variety of different ways. And particularly that one around the future tax cuts just highlights how you can take a smaller amount from a much wider range of people to offset these losses to a quite small group of people that are quite large, and do so in a very progressive way. Anyway, thank you.
Thank you very much indeed for that. Fantastically useful and depressing figures. How much would you not like to be advising the Chancellor this weekend in the Treasury as he sweats over the options? Here to help him, I think The Guardian said that this today was a cross-party conference, a non-party helpline. And here to help the Chancellor first, I'm going to ask Frank Field to say a few words.
Great. Thank you. There are different approaches we can take on this. We can act as party politicians would, and that is to suggest ways in which these reforms, cuts to tax credits, are abolished or mitigated. Or we can start where the government has started, on a journey certainly, and try and work within the framework which they are suggesting they are working to. I'm not saying that other activities are not important. They certainly are, and those suggestions about how these changes could be not only mitigated but put to one side are ones in which I hope lobby groups and political parties will mobilise around in the near future. But I start from a simple point, a reading of the political scene as I see it, and that is the government has imposed on itself, because it feels it is crucial to the outcome of its stewardship during this parliament, they wish to impose an iron envelope within which any changes may be made, and that iron envelope is a commitment to a high wage, low tax, low welfare economy. Now, we may wish to disagree with that, we may argue on that, but that's where the government is going to try and promote reforms. And if we wish to influence them, I believe we have to work within that framework. So although it is immensely tempting to talk about that the government should put aside the triple lock for pensioners, and the Select Committee will be looking at that issue during this Parliament so that we don't get political parties committed to welfare reform, which puts any strain of any changes on the working population. I do not believe that that is possible politics in the near future, even if it may be towards the end of the Parliament. Secondly, I welcome Resolution Foundation raising the question about pension tax relief, but I think there is no possibility whatsoever of the government quite rightly questioning pension tax relief to make major changes to its welfare reform programme or welfare reform cuts, whichever phrase you wish to use. And certainly before the end of the year, I want to return and look at pension tax relief, how it is inequitable, how it is unjust, and how this offers the government a glorified and glorious opportunity to build up a sovereign wealth fund in this country as it reduces pension tax relief. But I do not believe, I wish it were otherwise, I do not believe that either spreading the burden over the whole population, much as I would welcome that, or that we're raiding pension tax relief is going to be on the agenda of this government. The Select Committee, I hope, will be publishing a collective view about what the moves the government might consider, and today I'm merely speaking as a backbencher. And it is a backbencher who has seen already significant changes in the debate since the Chancellor announced in his budget, although didn't include it in his budget, the biggest ever cuts in welfare that we've seen since 1945. And my contribution to that debate then was that I was sure that these reforms would go through, but once the realisation of what they meant to actual families in real constituencies, the opposition would spread like bushfire across the Tory benches, and that is beginning to happen. So we've seen then changes from the government's position, or literally there is going to be no change, to a position where the House of Lords voted down on two occasions the statutory instrument giving the government authority to bring these changes in, and then thirdly, I think it was last week, when the House of Commons had its own debate, and I think perhaps nearly as significant to the defeat in the House of Lords was the numbers of Tories who were prepared either to put their name on that motion or were prepared to vote for that motion in the lobbies. And the total, as you may know, is 20. The government in a situation may well be able to twist arms, legs, necks and God knows what to pull back some of that total. I think the government realises that it does not now have a majority in the House of Commons when you consider the numbers who have publicly declared themselves for a reform programme or a programme of cuts of the like unchanged that the Chancellor announced in his budget. And therefore, I think we should applaud those Tories, because it's easy for opposition MPs to oppose governments. It is jolly, jolly hard for Tories with all the mechanisms at the whip's disposal to make inflexible views highly flexible. Therefore, my starting position is, what can we propose now which minimises the hurt? Secondly, delays the hurt, if there is to be hurt, to ensure that in fact some people are not hurt at all, and fourthly, not to be beguiled by universal credit. This is a vanity project which the Secretary of State is much committed to. It is not the white horse that is going to come over the hills to rescue the government on the position that it's got itself in by announcing these changes. The rollout of this benefit is particularly mild, to put it in higher terms than that. But my starting position for proposing reforms which meet those criteria to minimise hurt, to delay hurt, to protect some from any hurt, is to start from the change that the Chancellor has announced to the whole welfare reform debate in this country by proposing a national living wage. We have not seen a move like that from government since the Elizabethans began to propose poor law and welfare reform by that means. We have had centuries of very clever and well-meaning politicians who have proposed various ranges of benefits to compensate what is called the diswelfare of capitalism. The Chancellor in that budget speech said that is an end to that debate. The diswelfares of capitalism as regards those people at work now have to be borne by capitalism itself. And I think even though we are now months on from that statement, people are finding it very, very, very hard to wake up to what a revolutionary move he has begun by actually making that commitment. And what I'm proposing here, for consideration only, is that we take that into account and therefore look at what would a tax credit system look like once you've got a government seriously committed to a national living wage and one which actually is in future dependent on rises in productivity. For that in the long term is where the economic welfare of our country lies. And it does mean that welfare reform is now switching from IDS to the industry department, where SABID is clearly, as the government unrolls its productivity proposals, is going to be in the driving seat for the next big round of welfare changes. So let me outline what I propose within the framework in which I think the government might listen, not the framework that I would find desirable. Move one is that the government should slow down, that the full effects of these changes should not be felt until 2020. That it is very significant of all the Conservatives that spoke in last Thursday's debate and all the private conversations I've had with backbenchers who have talked about the message that they've relayed through their whips to the government or have relayed it directly to the centre of government, is that changes before 2017 are not acceptable. That, therefore, begins to open up the possibility of serious reform to tax credits itself, rather than thinking about how do we reform it within the existing structure of tax credit. Secondly, the second proposal of reform is that by 2020, the wage system should take the welfare responsibilities of people at work. And therefore, we would see the national living wage as being the main form of reward for people who are single or who are childless. Now, clearly some people at work now who are people with disabilities, many of them with suffering from mental health illnesses, will not be able to front up even by 2020 and be able to work a full working week. And therefore, it would require changes to the eligibility rules for JSA and ESA, which look after this particularly vulnerable group so they do not lose. Thirdly, the benefit therefore should revert to what it was originally intended, and this was a benefit for families with children. But I don't believe it's a benefit that should be, as it had at one stage, be benefiting MPs with children. And I think that we should be setting a cut-off point to eligibility for those with children. And I would suggest it would be twice the national living wage, and therefore it would be a benefit honed into those families with children earning up to 26k a year. The fourth reform that I would suggest, because the Chancellor has now started to give leeway that there will be money available for the transition, as he wishes to call it, so let's use it as his name, is that during the period between now and 2020, we need to be able to develop the skills in Job Centre Plus so that all those who are on tax credit can be interviewed, can be supported, and supported over a longish period of time to seek employment within their existing jobs, to work longer hours, or in fact to seek new jobs, so that they themselves, by their own efforts, are able to free themselves from a higher dependence on tax credits, and to work with the grain of human nature. I propose that those who are able to do so, to increase their tax credits during this period by up to 5,000 a year, their income, they should be able to keep that income in full. Now, it's true that I cannot give you who benefits by how much, who loses by how much. It is a structure within which I certainly, until we have more information, will, as an individual backbencher, be campaigning. But I underscore what was very politely put in that resolution presentation, and that is that there can never have been such a major change affecting the living standards of our fellow citizens, with so little information being made available in the public domain for us to actually work out who benefits or who gains, and more importantly, within whatever envelope the government wishes to conduct its reforms, what would be the cost, what would be the benefit, and then who would be the losers. But let me sum up with what I've been trying to say today. The starting point is that many of us have been slow to take on board the significance of a national living wage strategy. It does tear up a welfare agreement that goes back to the Elizabethan period. The government is now sending out a very clear cry that the dis-welfare of capitalism, i.e. appallingly low wages, should not be dealt with generally by taxpayers, but should actually be borne by capitalism itself. It does, as I've emphasised in this presentation, change the whole of the welfare debate from necessarily looking at, as we were looking at today, marginal tax rates, changes here, changes there, to the central economic debate which faces the country, and that is, how do we raise productivity, and particularly and most challengingly, how do we raise productivity for those who are at the moment drawing the lowest value? Secondly, what I propose today suggests that we should withdraw the wages subsidy, not next April, but over a longer period up to 2020. And thirdly, I proposed that the proper role of welfare is to take on those costs that no capitalist system is able to take on, and that is to vary wage packets depending on the numbers of children in a family. And that is a legitimate role for child benefit and for a reformed tax credit system. It's not a duty we can place on firms. It is a duty that we need to place on us as taxpayers, given that the vast majority of us in the original round tree starting us off on this dis-welfare of capitalism talked about the life cycle of earnings and the incomes that actually match that. And it would take us back to that original starting point and not actually continue down the highways and byways of developing ever more complicated systems of welfare, which has these huge difficulties in reforming, mega difficulties in understanding, and having even greater obstacle to clarity for those people who are on the receiving end, who have to make real decisions about how they live their lives and how they might, through self-interest, promote the common good by being able to raise their earnings. Those then are some suggestions that I've made today. They are inadequate, not because I wished it to be inadequate, but because we're in this extraordinary phase of welfare reform where we've never been presented with a bigger or more significant reform, or a government less willing to give us the data to look at what the nature of that reform is, or what the alternatives might be, even with that iron law of reform, which again end on, but I emphasise to you, the government is committed to a high wage, low tax, low welfare society, and if we're trying to influence them now on behalf of those who have least in our society, it's just as well to start where the government starts rather than rant at the government where we would like them to start.
For that, thinking the unthinkable still within the realms of the possible, and to look, you touched a lot on the politics there, it was your foundation, but to look very much at politics now as well from a conservative perspective, the founder of Conservative Home, distinguished Times columnist, Tim Montgomery.
Well, thank you very much for a fascinating presentation so far. Gary mentioned that this is my last full day in Britain. I leave for America for the Times tomorrow. So given what I might be about to say, it's probably a good thing. position in the Conservative Party. I was recently told by a cabinet minister, you may remember when the tax credit row was at its height, there was a suggestion that the Tories were going to flood the House of Lords with new peers. And a cabinet minister said, I've got really good news for you. He said, you're at the top of the list, David Cameron's peerages list. I thought that was very nice. And he said, the bad news is it's the list of people who will never, ever. So I'm going to carry on in that light, seeing I've been ruled out of the preferment, I might as well not hold back. The first thing I should say, and I think Frank has been generous on this point, I think, towards the government, there is a big project which George Osborne is trying to engineer in incredibly difficult times here. This is not a free market, laissez-faire, fundamentalist libertarian, zero state kind of conservative government. They are actually making some of the kind of interventions that Thorsten Bell might recognise in the economy. The introduction of the living wage, national living wage at least, that Frank has acknowledged, the apprenticeship levy, general willingness to intervene by this government, appointing Andrew Adonis on the infrastructure fund. There's an acknowledgement that government has to be involved in a whole range of ways that a free market conservative wouldn't necessarily acknowledge. We have got this massive deficit that needs to be cleared, and I think you have conservative ministers saying to business, saying to capitalists, that it isn't enough for you to just expect government to pick up the bill all of the time. Another minister said to me the other day, from his perspective, there wasn't really a fundamental difference between the subsidies that government used to pay in the 1970s to loss-making industries directly, and the subsidies that government is paying to supermarkets and other low-wage firms at the moment through the tax credit system. And phasing that out, that government intervention, resetting the rules of the game, that's a big project. It's fraught with difficulty, particularly the implications for the care sector of introducing this national living wage. But it is a big project, and I think it's an admirable project. And before I get into the criticisms of where I think the government is going, I would really like to acknowledge that. But this is terrible politics overall, to cut tax credits as fast and in the way that David Finch has described. I don't think when the Conservatives promised their £12 billion of welfare cuts in their manifesto, they ever expected to have to enact all of them. Linton Crosby says that he predicted a Conservative majority, but he hasn't yet released the polling behind his expectations, and I see Peter Kalmer there at the back, and I think there was quite a lot of us were very surprised at the election outcome. This was a manifesto and a set of cuts that the Tories proposed as a negotiating stance, not as a plan. But because of the Conservatives' minority position in the House of Lords, they've already been repeatedly defeated in the House of Lords, they need to stick by their manifesto to get anything through. Because the only authority they have in a House where they have such a minority is to stick closely to these policies, which is why they are, at least at the moment, trying to stick to that first course. And it's a fantastic presentation by David Finch, and I look forward to going through it later. Some of it I understood, some of it I will have to re-examine. But I think perhaps the bottom line is, if you are proposing to make £12 billion of cuts, you know, that's 12 million people who will lose £1,000 a year. I think that's right. So, you know, whatever, that for me is the key statistic. However much you taper, however much you phase, however much you graduate, if you're making £12 billion of cuts, you're taking £1,000 away from 12 million people. Now, that's a lot of money, and it means the cuts are very considerable. And Frank is right and realistic to say, if only the government changed the ring fencing on things like pensions, if only they would abandon promises, for example, to continue to freeze fuel duty, a ludicrous policy, I think, when you have petrol oil prices around the world tumbling. Now, we would really be able to cut back that £12 billion number. I'm not entirely as defeatist, I think, as Frank on this front. Perhaps he is more realistic. He's observed governments perhaps more closely than I have over the years. But because the politics of it are so awful, I still kind of hope that there will be some kind of revisiting of that ring fencing in some way. It was put to me really simply why there needs to be some kind of change. Just as that £12 billion figure, £1,000 of cuts for 12 million people is perhaps one of my headlines for you. The other headline is, you cannot fight a general election saying you are standing up for hard-working families and cut benefits for hard-working families. No, it really is as simple as that. The Conservative Party had a very lucky break at the last general election. They won an election they didn't expect to win. They won an election, so apologies to Austin for this, but they won an election because the Labour leader was thought to be unelectable. There wasn't great enthusiasm for my party. I think my party starts winning majorities and deserving to win majorities when it has that blue-collar appeal that Margaret Thatcher and Norman Tebbit gave it in the 1980s. It's only getting 37% at the moment, 4, 5, 6 points less than Mrs. Thatcher managed. You don't start to build that support by pursuing this kind of policy. And you know, it isn't just me and awkward columnists who are thinking about this, who are worrying about this. When you have The Sun, The Spectator, Boris Johnson, Zach Goldsmith, that bleeding heart liberal David Davis, that soppy lefty Liam Fox, you know, the leader of the Scottish Conservatives, Ruth Davidson, the leader of the Welsh Conservatives, Andrew R.T. Davis, the 20 Tory MPs that Frank Field mentioned, you know, you've got a massive rebellion on your hands. And so my prediction is, I don't think George Osborne will tweak. I don't think he will taper. Or adjust very much at the margins. Because I think if he does just try and get away with this, he won't be defeated in the Lords, he'll be defeated in the Commons. And that isn't just the end of his leadership ambitions, it's the end of his chancellorship. You know, he would have to resign if he's defeated on this side of the measure. So I think he has to make quite a big change. I don't know what that would be, but I think what we essentially have is the tax credit proposals as currently constituted are, for all intents and purposes, dead. Now, this might be an entirely coincident what we've seen in the last couple of days, but some of you might have noticed a press release from the Centre for Social Justice in the last 24, 48 hours warning George Osborne not to raid Universal Credit, which to pay for amelioration. Now, as I say, it may just be a coincidence, but the new director of the Centre for Social Justice is the old director of the Centre for Social Justice before she went to work for Ian Duncan Smith, Philippa Stroud. Now, Baroness Stroud, who helped Ian Duncan Smith for the last 6 years before she left. And I think that Philippa might not have just entirely been speaking on behalf of herself sending out that press release. I do not know, but I think it's a new play. You know, the Resolution Foundation has been a fantastic contributor to this debate, but we have a new contributor to this debate now. I think the Centre for Social Justice is going to be a much harder punching organisation in the second half of the austerity and the deficit reduction programme. What, of course, the government should be doing is it should be taking on the middle classes. You can cut the deficit and look after the hard-working families if you start taking on pensions, child benefit, and not increasing a personal tax allowance where 85% of the benefit goes to the top half of earners. Where I think we need to be over the course of this Parliament, I do think the election of Jeremy Corbyn gives the Conservatives a huge opportunity. They don't need to go into the next election repeating all of the ring fencing that has made their job so difficult this time. They have to be more ambitious. It's ludicrous to be increasing pensions by 2.5% when inflation is actually negative. But only a limited amount of that will be ameliorated in this Parliament. We need some bigger thinking, particularly on asset management of government assets. There's a huge amount of wealth of land and property that the government owns that there's no way near enough sweating properly and making enough income. But ultimately, we are going to continue to be meeting in fora like this until the Labour Party and the Conservative Party are either willing to raise taxes on middle class people or cut the entitlements of middle class people. There isn't a solution by increasing the taxes on the rich that is going to produce enough revenue, and there's not enough there's no socially just way of getting rid of the deficit if we cut the benefits of the poorest people. At the moment we have a political class that won't confront the middle classes. Nearly every advanced nation, until we have that political class, we'll be back here wrestling with these numbers again and again and again. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much indeed, Tim. I'll ask Julian to go to the microphone. As I said, maybe he's done more really to talk about the race and poverty, and love you to address us.
Thank you very much, and thank you all for this incredibly interesting and enlightening presentation we've had, and two very different perspectives from two seasoned political observers. Frank counseled us to start with the reality of where the government is. I want to start with the reality of where the labour market is and where families currently are. We are introducing these changes at a time when the labour market has never been more insecure, more unreliable, and more short-term. We are asking people at the bottom end of what we politely call the income distribution, the poorest in our society, to take the very biggest risks as they go into that labour market. It's a labour market in which 4 out of 5 people who start low paid are low paid 10 years on. It's a labour market in which we face the massive productivity conundrum of understanding how it is that work in retail, in hospitality, and in care, largely, I have to say, done by women, entirely work that will never be offshored, is so poorly paid, so unreliable, and deemed to be so unproductive, and yet it is the very relational services on which our future prosperity rests. We are talking about households that have so little money that their contribution to their local economy is minimal, and therefore our return to growth in some of the towns and cities of the UK is vanishingly small. What we have in the proposals put before us are a number of very welcome things, and Joseph Rowntree Foundation and I hugely welcome the government's intervention on wage levels. Creating the National Living Wage has forced employers to take some responsibility, but that's not the same as securing household income. and to link tax credits simply with wage levels confuses entirely the purpose of tax credits, both working tax credits and child tax credits, which are there to support the household. No employer under any utopian system could be expected to pay different wages for people depending on how many children they had and what their family responsibilities were. Since the days of the family allowance, government has compensated people for the cost of household life. And the research that we have done, and Donald Hirsch is sitting here so he can give you the graphs about it later, is crystal clear about who the losers are with these approaches. And they are those families who are doing what the vast majority of the population do, have 1.5 parents going out to work. One parent working full-time, half a parent working part-time. The ratio that most of the research suggests is best for children, because children, all the evidence is clear, 15 hours of childcare is good for children. What we are hearing from this government is that actually the only way you can get out of poverty under the new arrangements is to have two parents working full-time. Now, I don't know about you, but I never saw the memo that said that was the new model for family life in the new government. And the problem with that approach, in which is the only possible route out of poverty at the bottom end, is that people in that very insecure work, who we are encouraging to work more for very good reasons, are trapped because of precisely the work incentives that have been so graphically described. Even worse off are the very large number of single parents, and the significantly large number of people with disabilities, with mental health conditions, and with long-term conditions, who, frankly, don't want to be on job seekers' allowance. They want to work, but will need to work in more part-time, more flexible ways. The iron triangle that we all understand about welfare is not, on this occasion, being tested in the right way, because these approaches don't get families and households out of poverty. They won't, in the long run, save money, because they won't get money back into the economy. And they take away at a stroke the work incentives, which are so central, I think rightly, to this government's approach. Now, I've said one thing I really welcome that the government has done, and that is the National Living Wage. Only a year ago, they also introduced the family test. The family test had 5 tests for every policy that was introduced. And there are 2 that I want to draw attention to. One was about significant detriment, and the other was about significant strain. If you are saying that people working in insecure, unreliable work have to cobble together between 2 parents a full-time, 2 full-time wages, you are breaching at least 2 of those tests. And if you say for the very large number of single parents, I know Fiona Weirs in the room will say this much more eloquently than me later, if you say to those single parents that you will, as our research shows, by 2020 be living at 82% below what our minimum income standards suggest you need, you are then saying that those children will be the benefit payments of the next generation. Because we know from all the research we've done that children raised in deep and persistent poverty will not be able to take advantage of the possibilities of making their lives different. We at Joseph Rowntree Foundation have argued for a long time that high levels of poverty of this sort are not just wrong, they're costly for society, they're wasteful for talent, and I believe they're hugely risky to the prospects of the next generation. I very much welcome Frank's constructive suggestions about how this can be changed, but what we need to bear in mind is there was a reason we introduced a family allowance, and that's because there is a fundamental contract between the state and the individual, or the individual household, which suggests that yes, you must work, and yes, you must raise your children. The state can offer some support in doing so. And that support is not the same as a high benefits culture. It's a recognition of the additional cost of raising children. Thank you.
Passionate remarks. You've got a whoop, which might be a first in the Resolution Foundation. As it was, just before I throw it open to questions, as it was in a sense a whoop against Frank and what he'd been saying, I just wonder whether we could come back to Frank. Julia's point that you can't rely on employers to compensate poor families.
Great. Can I just... It's easy.
Well, do you want to say where you are?
I wouldn't mind just for this standing up here. I welcome that challenge. because though I welcome the contribution that the Joseph Rowntree Foundation makes, I do think it becomes less and less relevant as each year goes on. That's different what it means to us in this room, of what our cardinal beliefs are, but I think it's now, each year, it moves further away from the electorate, which will decide elections, and I'm interested in winning elections, because by winning elections, you may well be able to make changes. What I've suggested is the second theme of what Julia was talking about, which is what we can expect households to produce in income towards their family and the country's well-being. I'm not advocating, nor do I think the government's advocating, that they can defend themselves. But we want to have an economy where both parents work full-time. The stunning piece of information from the poverty data, if you think the poverty data is relevant to the political debate, is that of the 3 million plus poor children, less than 100,000 exist in households where there is one full-time worker and one part-time worker. So we do not have an economy which demands full-time working from both parents, even if both parents want to work, and even if that is actually desirable for children. I'm not advocating that. And I'm slightly surprised by Julia's comments, because while my proposals would mainly benefit single parents, because they're on the lowest income, who would be drawing what I think should be the reshaped benefit, I do not think there is political capital in actually selling the proposal on that. I think you protect the poor by trying to present as large a group as possible that will actually benefit from any reform. And therefore, while they would be the main beneficiaries of abolishing the subsidy to low wages for families without children, I'm talking about a tax credit system which is about supporting families in work with children. And the main beneficiaries of that would be single parents, because they're on the lowest income, but they would not be the only beneficiaries. And I think politically, one wants to try and build a lobby which talks about families rather than dividing them up by marital status. My last point is, while it's helpful to have the Rowntree Foundation regularly to produce what is an acceptable living standard, it is not viable politics. While it's desirable, while it is the light on the hill to which we may be aiming, the idea that most of the electorate are going to sign up for a minimum income around that level, I don't think will be realised in my lifetime, which compared with some of you will be short, but I fear in many other people's lifetimes within this gathering. So my comments were about what is politically feasible given what we know the government is likely to do. And I disagree with Tim. I don't think the government's going to move against the middle classes. I think all the effort needs to be, how do we mitigate for some and wipe out the hurt for others of these tax credit changes. And when I responded to the budget, I spoke about, I couldn't understand the politics of a chancellor that was already planning 2020, which was that they were going to be the party of strivers against those on welfare, to have so seriously dive-bombed his election strategy by attacking these strivers. Now, that was unpopular by some people on our benches, because we shouldn't actually talk about strivers. I talk about strivers because the electorate talk about strivers. They are the strivers. They recognise the terms without having the effort of decoding them. And I think this is the real, real vulnerable point of this government, the only vulnerable point so far, that they, in the lead up to and during the election and after the election, they talked about they were the party of strivers. And then in their first budget of a clear Tory majority, as I say, they dive bomb on those very strivers, many of whom probably voted for them. income, and I think that is now spreading amongst the Tory benches, not through simply by fear that they will lose their votes of the Strivers and maybe their seats, but because many Tories stood in the election believing that they were going to be supporting the Strivers and are now increasingly horrified by the situation and the votes which they will be faced with. So one last comment, and I will sit down and join everybody else, Gary. I think the room for manoeuvre is quite narrow. I do think we have a chance of actually reshaping this benefit with more resources going to it than the government originally wanted to go to it, which is one which actually takes the strain off families who have children. And I think we might put them in a more advantageous position than elsewhere. And of course, I wasn't saying people should be simply on JSA. I was actually calling for changes in the eligibility so that people, whatever they earned, could continue to draw JSA and ESA if they were earning, so that people with real difficulties, difficulties that none of us actually face, and who brilliantly get out of bed and who want to work and who try and work, who see their whole dignity about the contribution that they're making themselves to their households and to the country. We want to actually be supporting those by changing these silly benefit rules. It's not at all about, it's trying to map in, under a language which I think is acceptable to the government, serious changes. And that's what the contribution that I was making today, and I'm sorry I've gone on so long. It's brilliant of Julia to get me going.
Donald Hirsch, as Julia mentioned, I used the quote of the analysis for the Pearson Grantley Foundation. I'm really pleased, actually, we're having this quite tense debate about... I'm really pleased that we're having this quite tense debate about what is actually being implied and what isn't, about how much people should work. The analysis that we did showed that, not surprisingly, that this narrative about, well, we're going to do this thing through earning rather than through benefits works best if you do have two people working full time. And there's a huge contrast between that narrative and the narrative we got in 2010 with the first announcement of universal credit, which was almost the opposite of saying we will help people to families to start working and work on many jobs and not sort of put all that pressure on them and allow them to keep their benefits. So it is kind of about the reality. And I'm in a way interested in Tim Montgomery's take on this or if you can channel Philippa Stroud, continue to do so. I agree with Frank that this living wage thing is a huge change on the labour market, and it's a huge welcome change. The question is, what are we saying to families? Are we saying, as Jeremy Hunt seemed to be saying, this is great because we can all be very Chinese and work every hour that we can, and if not, then the degree to which the wages help to compensate becomes much, much weaker, and that narrative weakens.
Tim, the China syndrome.
Thank you for an easy question. I think, I began by talking about the rules of the game need to change, and Paul Johnson of the IFS wrote an article for The Times shortly after the reform was announced and says the Chancellor is taking a big gamble. He is gambling that somehow business will start addressing the productivity problem, because otherwise this introduction of the living wage doesn't work. And it is an echo of that remark I made about the subsidy by government of industry in the 1970s held those industries back. They became complacent because they were relying on government money. The same is true of a lot of British retail and service sector at the moment. It isn't investing in their labour force because it can get them cheap. And so the challenge is, can this structural change in the way the UK labour market operates actually change how British workers are paid and invested in and trained, which is why you have to see it in the context of apprenticeship levy as well. And that if it can, and I do not know the answer to this question, it begins, I think, to resolve some of the tension between, very fascinating tension between Julia and Frank. But I think it needs wider change as well. I can't quite see how you protect the incomes of those at the bottom in this new environment when you also have open borders, which is effectively what you have as well. I think you do need to be able to control your immigration policy so that you, whatever changes David Cameron gets to EU migrant benefits, which he will not get in his renegotiation, is overwhelmed by the introduction of a national living wage. The national living wage is big news in Romania and Bulgaria, and everybody knows about it. It will undermine the ability to begin to protect the incomes of people at the bottom and that investment in productivity. So it's a gamble. I don't know how it will work out. But you know, the employment data, is it all, you know, back to this family point, is it all good news that we have an increasing proportion of our workforce in labour? Well, there are some downsides to having so many people away from the home, and I think there should be, there are worries about the employment growth as well as benefits.
There's no longer this, Tim, come down to what was going through George Osborne's mind, how did he end up here? Because that'll tell us what the real realms of the possible are. Was he trying to slay a dragon? Did he see his moment to reshape the state in a really big way? And that's something, a project he's not going to move away from? Or was it just groupthink and intolerance of criticism? What's your understanding of what was going on? How did we end up here?
You know, we have a massive deficit still. I think it almost is as simple as that. I think if these...
But how can you look at a chart that says that some of the poorest families are going to lose that much money per week straight away with barely any notice and not balk?
Well, I think you balk when at the same time you're raising the inheritance tax threshold, you're giving tax cuts to 40p taxpayers. I think if this measure, because this is exactly the kind of measure that is needed to get rid of the deficit, there's no doubt about it. If this measure had been presented as a package of lots of other cuts that are going to come in the autumn statement, I think we would have still found it horrendous, but we would have understood that perhaps we were all in this together. But I think part of the reason why it has been so unacceptable, it's been there in isolation, it's been standing on its own over the summer. But you know, the big issue of this Parliament is not going to be the Tory party fighting over Europe. The big issue of this Parliament is going to be cuts. There's still going to be cuts. The hardest cuts are all still to come. But, you know, I listened to Frank's recipe. I don't think it adds up. You know, I don't see how he gets any with that plan. He solves this problem. He doesn't solve the deficit problem with this. That's not his responsibility, fair enough. But cuts are going to be the story of this Parliament, and I think George Osborne's view is probably beginning to dawn on him how hard this is going to be. Because even if you put all the resolution measures that David presented to us to tackle this problem, it doesn't get rid of the rest of them.
One of the things we understand that George and his henchmen, I really don't think that's too strong a term, have been putting to reference is what could you tolerate? What's the annual loss, let's say we start next year, that you could tolerate to households? And they're getting back numbers like, and this plays into Frank's argument a bit, numbers like, say, 400 a year, so you know, just below £8 a week. And their views might change, are working back from numbers like that to try and see how they can fit the tolerance threshold of Tory MPs. I mean, is that a good way to make policy, or is it just realistically politics as it works, and what could we end up with if we go down the route?
One of the extraordinary things about this debate is the Chancellor's got himself in a hole. And anybody who suggests way out of the hole is then criticised as though one invented the hole and put him in it. The Chancellor gets out this hole by his own efforts. And what one can do is try and make recommendations. But I'm slightly more optimistic than Tim for two reasons. One is, apart from it's just jolly nice to have a surplus, why did the Chancellor put an 11 billion surplus in his accounts for 2020 if he didn't know it was going to be hard and the concessions didn't have to be made? And secondly, thank goodness, the last Parliament was characterised by employment increases, without tax revenue increases. And it's the employment increases are continuing and tax revenue is beginning to rise. So there will be pressure, in a sense, there of the Chancellor. My starting position is that he feels his political future is bound up with making some major changes to tax credits. It ain't going to budge. So given that money will leak into the system, because he's now beginning to hint that it will do, how do we get it, how do we present him a ladder out of the hole he's got himself in, which actually then leads to a better position afterwards? And I think that better position is, as Julia was making a plea, we know that the greatest strains on all families, and not just the very poorest families, are when families are actually responsible for children. And I agree with the point. The idea that you want to drive everybody out to work when we know that life chances are determined by five afterwards, we would be looking very carefully at the child care changes the government's making and asking questions about how that money is being used. But all these things are small compared with, I think he wants to be able to stand up and say he's changed tax credits. So do we come up with minuscule reforms or ones which he can actually step aside from the stench of this attack on the poorest people? And though he will lose, he won't get his £4.5 billion, he will end up as a welfare reformer that has totally changed tax credits. And that's what I'm actually after trying to influence. I may be foolish, it may be wrong, and all the rest of it, but that's what I think the politics of this Parliament and other parliaments is about.
Thank you. Lady there, and then the lady to the left of you. If you want to ask your questions, we'll take a couple of them in two. Not quite, no.
Hello, Lynn Mann from Mothers at Home Matter. I'd like to pick up on what Tim's just said, because it isn't good for our society to have everybody in employment all the time. Parents, mothers, fathers will work. They do work outside of the home for a period of their life. It's not about working all the time. A lot of institutions, schools, couldn't function if it wasn't for the fact that parents come in and help. They can only come in and help when they are unpaid. And we need to start thinking about how we can value our care in the home. It is worth £3.4 billion. People that don't go out to work, don't get paid, are not valued, and that needs to change.
Thank you.
I think this debate, the tax credit debate, has blown open the fact that below this hard-working family debate has happened for a number of years, that most children today in poverty are in working families. And actually, if we look at the distribution analysis of cuts that have been happening over a long period of time, that have been hitting families with children particularly hard, and single parents are structurally one earner, couples paying the childcare costs particularly hard. And lots of us have been having this very policy-techy debate inside the WWP for a long while about the different ways in which takers and disregards and all kinds of other things might affect different groups. So it's massively important that we've blown that whole debate open and said, let's understand who's affected and how working incentives are affected and how we as a society have a democratic open debate about it rather than these things decided by the handful of people who actually understand the graphs. And the second thing I wanted to raise was about looking at the long-term impact, because this government is trying to do a lot of things other than the deficit. So one of the things it's trying to do is improve education and attainment, the number of children in workless households, there's a whole full employment target, and all of these things could potentially be set back by measures that fail to make work pay, that remove business, the remove incentives that have been hugely important in getting their parents into employment for child. So we have to thoroughly assess the impact it will have on work incentives under universal credit and the effect it will have on employment levels, because, you know, 5% more single parents in work, Exeter have estimated can save 436 million. So the one thing you don't want to tamper with is getting more people into work and working more hours. And then thirdly, there is a massive debate opening up about how much time families have to work and the pressures on them. And I think we need to have it. So it's a question really for how we can use this fantastic opportunity around a very specific measure to have some of the big debates we need and not just go for a short-term solution.
Thank you very much indeed. And I'll just take the lady there in front of you and then
Hi, I'm Rebecca Fudd, I work at 38 Degrees, and we're running a big campaign against tax credit cuts at the moment. And the things that Julia spoke about really chimed with me, because we are a member-led organisation, so a hell of a lot of our members are going to be directly affected by cuts as they go through. And over the last few weeks, I've spoken to probably about 80 people on the phone who are going to be affected by it, trying to find people who are going to go and meet their MPs about it, or who kind of can talk to the local press. And just anecdotally, the thing that really struck me is that it's really going to affect women more than men. That we live in a society where if a family breaks up, it's women who look after the kids. Even in two-parent families, women look after the kids more. So I think if these cuts go through, it is going to push a lot more women into poverty than men. And I wondered, my question for the Resolution Foundation was whether any of your kind of analysis had looked specifically about how these cuts are going to hit women as opposed to men. And also to the panel, whether you think that this is kind of something that the government have taken into account politically, whether they've maybe underestimated the impact that that's going to have on their reputation amongst female voters, and whether you think that that's something that people who are campaigning to protect tax credits cuts should be focusing on or not.
Thank you very much indeed. Anyone on the panel want to come back? Duke, want to come back on that?
I suppose for both the points that you made, and Fiona's particularly, but also what you said, Rebecca, I think what this issue has done is raised very rapidly up the political agenda the reality of low pay and very tight household incomes. I don't think when it was first announced, the first responses to the summer budget were about the living wage. And as I've said, that was hugely welcome. It took time for this to come out, and Frank was very clear that huge change affecting very high percentage of the population has been done without that information being shared and properly analysed. And it's actually over the last few weeks that more and more of it has emerged. I don't think there's a massive conspiracy here. I think there's a desire to cut tax credits and a very understandable shock that they have risen so high. Now, I would argue they've risen so high because of the nature of our current labour market and the nature of some families and family life. How you deal with those, although Frank and I are disagreeing violently on lots of things here, is of course a matter that has to be done in a way that the electorate understands. A large percentage of the electorate don't believe they're on benefits, they are receiving tax credits. And this has changed the nature of public debate, and I think it's incredibly important we get it right. It's for politicians to come up with the exact measures that will make it work. And I think there's some very persuasive things being said today. But what we need to do is surface the issues.
Dave.
Directly on the question is, we have actually done some estimates, so we think around 70% of those cuts are directly affecting women's income, and that's largely because of the number of single parents that are in the tax credit population. But I think more widely the point around incentives, well, the people that tend to respond most to incentives are the single parents and second earners, and if you're weakening those incentives to go into work through these cuts, then you're potentially putting at risk the fact that so many will go into employment.
Thank you very much for that. Let's take the gentleman here, gentleman there, and the lady behind us.
Don Draper, I've been writing on tax for about a couple of decades, my colleague Lena Bacon. There's one option that I thought would appeal to a Conservative Chancellor and Conservative
Tim's party. Plane is leaving for America. Yes.
Where would we be without Tim? You know, he really is the ideal mould. There's one thing that ought to appeal to a Conservative Chancellor to mitigate the impact for not everybody but a group of people, and that is to look at the option of having an enhanced or additional personal allowance for families with children. We're very unusual in having an income tax system which takes no account of the family. And one of the reasons why we have tax credits was that we had stripped away all that support. And you can look at numbers. Obviously, everything is difficult in this area. But it does fit with a low tax, low welfare model. If you had an enhanced personal loans for families that could be paid for, probably, by freezing and holding the increase in the personal loans goes to us all. Why should this burden of reducing the deficit just be on families? Why shouldn't we all have to pay it? I was very struck, there's one figure in the Treasury documentation. They could have reduced the deficit by £4 billion next year by a simple 1p increase in the basic rate of tax, which means that I and the rest of us would be taking our share and not loading it on 2.5 million families.
Thank you. Reverend, if you just keep your question short, we might get the chance to come back to the panel. Thank you.
I live in the London Borough of Haringey, where 58% of the households are tenants, 47% of London households are tenants, and 33% in England. They are suffering already the massive increase in their rents against incomes which are about apparently to be cut by tax credit being cut. The rents are going up, and therefore reduced the amount of money available for food, clothes, fuel and transport. They are not gaining a single penny from the massive increase in the housing market, where if you own your property, you're all looking a lot more wealthy. This is a harsh injustice at the heart of the economy. Nobody has talked about it today. I can't believe we can talk about incomes without talking about incomes after housing costs. And I just think it ought to be right on the top of the agenda, because the tax credit crunch will make it far worse.
Thank you so much. And please, just take a little turn, the third row. Just go ahead. Thank you.
Thank you. Pamela Calder, Early Childhood Studies Degrees Network. I also wanted to raise some things that I think have been not mentioned. And that is, what is a working week? I mean, there's an assumption that this is going to be very long. But we could have plans to have 35 hours a week, and this would change the notion of what two-parent families could do and also have time with their children. And these things need to be taken in the round, along with leave policies, paternity and maternity leave. And also, I wanted to mention a bit of what I think is misinformation. The suggestion that 30 hours free childcare could somehow compensate for what is being taken away is even more unlikely to work, because at the moment the 15 hours is free and doesn't depend on you working. So all that anyway is being offered with an extension to 30 hours is another 15 hours only to the working parents. No discussions about the quality of what is offered. Could be very low quality childminding or private nurseries who may go to the wall at any point. And also think about the impact on the child. If the parent loses their job, if you're in some kind of childcare and education which depends upon your parents working, you lose as a child, you lose your friends, you lose your place at the same time as your parent loses a job. There are many more wider factors here that make it an issue that in many ways is gender-related, affects families and affects children, than are being looked into.
Thank you very much indeed. And just to answer any of the points that were raised that they fancy answering, and to a closing thought, because we're right up against the buffers now, could I ask Julia first?
I think your point about housing is a really important one. The IFS today have produced a report that says that the imposed 1% reduction in rents for social tenants will actually benefit the exchequer in ways that it won't benefit the households because of the structure of housing benefit. It's absolutely central to this discussion, and we should always take into account both the extremely high cost of housing for the poorest households, who pay a much higher proportion of their income into housing. I didn't raise it in this issue because actually the tax credits is slightly different.
I've got three comments, if I may, from 1 to 38 degrees. I hope you will continue, while collecting support more generally in the House of Commons, this vote will be decided by how Tory backbenchers behave. And therefore, your centering on that, I think, is crucial for the outcome. And it will also show us, I hope, how powerful the web can be in actually implementing political decisions. It will take us into a new area there. Secondly, it's again the politics of this. Any welfare cuts are bound to affect women more than men, because women are more greater beneficiaries of welfare. But if one wants to try and build the widest alliance in the country, I would beg you to talk about the cuts on children. Because if you're cutting women's income, you're cutting children's income as well. And I think there's more support in the country for not doing a tax on children than there are, sadly, making cuts to women's income. Thirdly, this is a debate about survival for some families. And while, of course, I accept the argument about the personal allowances and endlessly supported that, it's a luxury, really, to be talking how that might save some families from the doom that is actually going to engulf them if we cannot get the government to shift. And I was reading a report last night from a project which I support in Birkenhead, which is looking at what interventions are more powerful than income in class in determining life chances, which are over by five. And we know that there are three main ones, one of which is the mental health of the mother. This is an intervention that we're trying to do with vulnerable mothers. And we found that what we were doing, as well as trying to deal with the greater nurturing of the mother, we've got mothers who are pregnant or have just given birth with no bed, no mattress, no food. That's before all of these changes come into force. And it raises questions for me, what the hell the sort of society we got when very vulnerable mums are on their own giving birth to a child and they haven't got a bed. Others, if they've got a bed, have got no mattress to go on the bed, and others have not got food. And I think it's that position about how do we protect children and therefore their families within this framework is what I'm all about. And of course it would be wonderful to tell you what I'd love to see by 2020. This is a fight for survival of some families, and the whole of my efforts and whatever intelligence I've got and abilities to try and shift government are about that, not about getting credit from you, saying what a wonderful radical he is, he's come up with all these proposals. I'm not interested in that. I am interested between trying to protect families who will be pushed below the waterline.
Thank you so much. On your behalf, I'd like to thank Tim, who's disappeared. Maybe he's on the QE2 on a slow boat to America. To thank Frank and to thank Julia, but I think most of all, to thank David and the whole resolution team for their analysis and for hosting us and making this all possible. Thank you.